It's this rock. This rock in the middle will be debated for a very long time. Maybe it's Britain's most debated rock, and for good reason, to be honest.
I'm Tony, a PhD student in geology at Curtin University in Western Australia. And I showed, me and my team showed, that the central six-ton rock of Stonehenge, the Alterstone, came from the Acadian Basin of northeast Scotland.
Wow. And how far away is that from Stonehenge, roughly?
Well, I've been saying 700 kilometres, but then I realised people in the UK use miles, so it's something like 400-something miles.
That's a long way.
The origins of this rock being somewhere around Orkney is really fascinating for us archaeology nerds, because Orkney is home to so much incredible Neolithic archaeology. The stones of Stennis, Ring of Brodgar, Mace Howe, and most importantly, of course, the Scarabray Buddo. I love this little chap. Honestly, the results of this research couldn't have been more dramatic, really. And Tony, the man behind the work, member of the team behind the work, was kind enough to chat to me about it, because I just love knowing how we know these things. Do you know what I mean? When a big claim is made, I just want to know how we know. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Britain's most debated rock. This isn't going to be the last time you hear about this rock.
Okay, let's see here. I'm going to be honest, I had never heard of the Alterstone, or if I had, maybe I'd forgotten about it. I don't know. It's really concealed at Stonehenge. So the Alterstone is this rock buried between two large sarsens that fell on it some point in prehistory. It's right in the middle of Stonehenge. It was probably given the name Alterstone by Inigo Jones, a 17th century architect who wrote,
"Whether it be an altar or not, I leave to the judgment of others."
We don't actually know if it was an altar in any meaningful sense. We don't really know the rituals that went on at Stonehenge. But it must have had an important role, being placed right in the centre. And according to Tony, geologically, it is quite distinctive too.
Yeah, it's always been the odd one out. So the blue stones from southwest Wales are igneous rocks. They form from cooling magma beneath the Earth's surface. The large upright sarsens are from a kind of sandstone that's been heavily silicified, so kind of cemented by other silica-rich fluids. They're very distinctive. But the Alterstone is this green-grey micaceous sandstone that's fine to medium-grained. It really is quite distinct in the Stonehenge context, and also the surrounding Salisbury Plain. It's not from the local area.
I honestly wish I knew more about geology. I'd love to point at a rock and be like, oh yeah, classic igneous. Can't mistake that. Maybe as I become more and more middle-aged, rocks will be my thing. I don't know. It is interesting. So you have this distinctive rock, seemingly not from the local area. How does Tony and geologists go about pinning it to the north of Scotland, or deciding where any rock comes from, for that matter?
Yeah, so the Alterstone is a sandstone, which means it's made up of lots of minute, compacted together mineral grains, kind of like grains of sand at a beach. And each of those grains will have a unique age and chemical characteristics that we can determine using the instrumentation at my university.
Basically, as Tony said there, sandstone is of course made up of sand from the underlying geology. And this makes sort of every bed of sandstone unique, I believe. It has its own unique profile just based on the minerals that made it. These minerals, these rocks, can then be dated. And it kind of works similar to radiocarbon dating. They're dating the decay of these atoms. Radiocarbon dating measures the decay of carbon-14 into nitrogen-14, which takes like 50,000 years. After 50,000 years, it's all totally decayed. According to Tony, they measure the rocks in exactly the same way, but I was curious, like, what's actually being measured?
So we turn to the decay of uranium to lead, which occurs over geological time frames. We're talking hundreds of millions to billions of years. So we have a grain that's crystallized, and it will incorporate some uranium from the surrounding magma. Below a certain temperature, it takes in no more uranium, so you can think of the clock as having started.
Tony blasts these minerals, these rocks, with a laser smaller than a human hair. And then in the gas that's given off, he can measure the ratio of uranium to lead. Kind of crazy. This was a small aside, but I did wonder then, does that mean all the lead on the Earth is like 1 billion, 2 billion years old? Does that mean all the lead we have in the Earth is at least 2 billion years old?
Yeah, it's kind of there's lots of different isotopes or kind of kinds of lead.
Yeah.
Some are called, it's called common lead, which has always been there. It's like from primordial, it's from when the solar system formed. Other lead is called radiogenic lead. Anyway, lead isotopes are the whole other thing. It's a whole discipline.
Yeah, I'm sure.
It's very, very...
Down a rabbit hole. That was just a thought that popped into my head.
It's fascinating.
Anyhow, they zap the rock with the laser, they measure the uranium to lead, they get the ages of all these different minerals, and because each bed of sandstone is kind of unique, they can then try and match it to other sandstone beds. Do you see what I'm saying? I hope I explained that clearly. Apologies if not. All right, let's see the ages of these rocks.
So this underlying geology is broken up into so-called terrains. A terrain is just an area of shared geology in terms of chemistry and age. So the geology of southern Britain is called East Avalonia. It's East Avalonian bedrock. If we move northwards across that thick black line there, just by the north of Wales, we're into Ganderia, which is another distinctive terrain. Moving further northwards, we come into a terrain which forms most of the bedrock of Scotland called Laurentia.
This is the age profile of rocks in England, East Avalonia. As you can see, they're kind of made up mainly of rocks that formed in one event just over a billion years ago. This is the age profile of the rocks in Orkney. They formed later and are also formed of a wide variety of ages. When we show the sample of the altar stone, you can see it clearly lines up with those from Orkney and Scotland much, much more than it does from the samples from England. And this is the same for the other samples taken from around Britain too.
And if we look at the red chart there at the top, you'll notice that we're seeing maybe three dominant peaks, much like what we see for Laurentia and the Acadian Basin. In other words, it's the same rock.
How confident are you that this rock came from the Acadian Basin? Like, is there a margin of error? What's your confidence level?
There's certainly a margin of error. We, as geochronologists, we operate within uncertainty. We can determine things to a degree of uncertainty at a given level. I may determine the age of a zircon to be, say, 1.4 billion years old, plus or minus 5 or 10 million years. We're dealing in percentages error here. So taken together with this zircon profile that we built, the age profile, we're greater than 95% certain that it comes from the Orcadian Basin. Or the Orcadian Basin ages and the altar stone are the same. That's kind of where we're at.
Okay. This research can be refined further and further. In fact, it's already begun. This process has already begun. This is Britain's most debated rock. Already since Tony's paper came out, geologists have been up in Orkney doing what they do to rocks. And apparently the altar stone is not the same makeup as the stones from the Ring of Brodgar and the big sites on Orkney. So they believe that the island of Orkney is now ruled out as the original location of the altar stone, but it could have come from other places in the far north of Scotland. I would 100% guarantee right now there are teams of geologists scouring the north of Scotland trying to be the first ones to find the original location of this stone. I guarantee it. It's a geology bonanza up there right now. So Tony is 95% confident that the age of the altar stone is the same age as the rocks from the Orcadian Basin, and that therefore they're the same rock. So how did it get all the way down to Stonehenge? This is where another debate will really be going down for a long time. Do you have any strong opinion on that? What do you think about how it got all the way down to southern England?
Yeah, these are those kind of fascinating, maybe unanswerable questions, but in the paper, I do put forward my opinion, and I think my opinion is based on kind of three options here. We look at maybe a glacial transport, like you described, a overland transport route, and a marine transport route.
The first option, as Tony said there, is that the rock was moved by a glacier. Glaciers are a very powerful geological force. They can move rocks all over the place. Currently, though, Tony's team does not prefer this explanation.
And in terms of glacial transport route, the ice was moving in the wrong way. The ice was kind of emanating from the Grampian Mountains, moving northwards, taking material even further away from southern Britain towards, you know, the North Sea and the North Atlantic Ocean. It was taking stuff away. There's also no evidence of glacial erratics on the Salisbury Plain. The altar stone shows no evidence of being transported by ice. You know, it's a rather weak rock, a sandstone. Would it really survive a multi, you know, glacial journey hundreds of kilometers south? I'm not sure.
It's possible glaciers at various times move the rock some of the way, maybe as far as northern England. It's a possibility, but humans must have been involved in moving it some way if there's no evidence of glacial action on the Salisbury Plain. And there's actually a lot of really good evidence that they moved it all the way from Scotland.
If we look at an overland route, prehistoric Britain, some say it was very heavily forested, like a temperate rainforest. It would have been, even today, a journey from Scotland is arduous overland. But then we have mountains and rivers to contend with. Incredibly difficult, not impossible. But we know that there was Neolithic shipping.
This right here on screen now is a mace head made of gneiss rock. It's a nice rock. This came from the island of Lewis. This rock traveled all the way from Lewis in the Outer Hebrides. Long, long way to go. And to be placed in a burial with someone, it was almost certainly a prized item. It's a nice rock. This right here on the screen now is called grooved ware pottery. It's a common form of Neolithic pottery in Britain, found around Stonehenge, found in other places too. The earliest places we find it is around Orkney. Intriguingly, fascinatingly, the creators of this pottery, the fashion icons of the Neolithic Age, there's good evidence they liked to party down in Stonehenge. What you're looking at now is a paper, a bit of research that analyzed all the animal remains found at Durrington Walls, which was a big Neolithic settlement by Stonehenge. It's probably where the builders of Stonehenge lived. And there's a lot of evidence there for feasting, partying, fun stuff going on down there 5,000 years ago. Scientists can use isotopes to analyze the bones and teeth of animals and figure out where they came from, because these bones and teeth, they're picking up minerals from the local geology. It's all about geology, this video. Animals being eaten at Durrington Walls by probably the same people building and using Stonehenge came from all over Britain, including Scotland. If an animal is traveling that far, if a cow, a pig is traveling that far, it's not doing it on its own, right? Someone had to travel with it, and maybe they brought a 6-ton rock with them. The last evidence I have of big, far connections in Neolithic Britain is the vole, specifically the Orkney vole. I didn't know this at all until I started researching this video. But the Orkney vole only lives there, doesn't live anywhere else in Britain, and its closest relatives are the common vole in Europe. And we have remains of the Orkney vole from archaeological excavations that are at least 4,600 years old, back to the Neolithic period. So this little mousy chap and chapette are believed to have been stowaways on a boat that sailed from Europe all the way to Orkney in the Neolithic period. That's the easiest explanation we have for them being up in Orkney and nowhere else in Britain. They had to have gotten there via some route. They had to have skipped over the island of Britain. It's incredible, isn't it? It's really incredible the lines of evidence we can tease apart to try and understand ancient history. The DNA of a vole on a Scottish island can tell us so much. I love it. I love it. I love little things like that. It's why I love archaeology. Shout out to voles, man. Shout out.
Are you coming back? Yeah.
I said, what's the big deal? I don't care about thanks. We'll take
yeah.
care.
Yeah.
I'm a good guy.
Yeah.
I can't wait to look at some of your films.
I had heard some chatter online casting a bit of doubt on this discovery, maybe because it's just an illogical thing to do, to move a 6-ton rock 750 kilometers, 400 odd miles. Why go to that effort when there's sandstone around Stonehenge? But the thing is, humans do stuff like that all the time. Moving rocks is honestly one of our favorite things to do. Stonehenge wasn't built out of some desire for maximum efficiency. It was built because it meant something to the people that made it. Not just there in Stonehenge, but from Wales, where the bluestone came from, and the north of Scotland, where this altar stone came from. It really goes to show how interconnected Neolithic Britain was. Like, you're not gonna move a 6-ton rock all that way if you didn't know about Stonehenge and be sort of involved in the ideology, the symbolism, the community behind it. It's fascinating to imagine life back then and what these sites meant to these people. Not just Stonehenge and Orkney, but all the sites in between those two points, that most of which we've lost now. It's, great to daydream about, but difficult to answer with any certainty. But one thing there is certain for sure, this is not the last time you've heard about this rock. It's going to be Britain's most debated rock for a long time to come.
Hello, thank you for watching. Quick recommendation for you. If you are interested in archaeology, and specifically how humans built our environment, why we evolved that sense to build our environment, check out Carter's next symposium. Carter is an organization at San Diego University, California, San Diego, and they're trying to make academic information more accessible, kind of like what I do, but they host conferences that anyone can attend. The next one is on a built environment. It is on October 11th, 2024. They're talking about Göbekli Tepe, talking about brain evolution, talking about the origins of architecture, all sorts of interesting stuff, and it's free to attend. So I'll put the link in the description. Check it out. You'll like it if you like this stuff. And thank you for watching.